Warning, you, yes, you may be at risk of a heart attack. And the shocking truth about your child's school. This and so much more on, just joking, yeah. But did I get your attention? Did those headlines make you kind of go like, whoa, what's happening here? If it did, that was the intent. Because we understand, just like you do, that there is a power in the emotion of fear. If we can create an element of fear, just a little bit of doubt in someone's mind, then in turn, we can capture their attention and perhaps motivate them to do or buy what we want. And that's our subject today here on what used to be the Beatitudes Worship Podcast. Instead, we've switched the name around a little bit. We have a brand new set, as you can see behind me. And the one thing we did not change, however, our tech people and the incredible, the invincible, the all-knowing, Miss Janelle.
Good morning.
When's the last time someone talked to you like that, huh?
Not too long ago, actually.
Oh, jeez. Give me a break.
I am just kidding. Good morning, Tony.
Good morning. How are you? So, hey, we've got, like, new changes. We're in a new setting.
Yeah, it's exciting.
We have a new set behind us.
Right.
And there's a new name.
A new name.
Tell me about that, please.
MonoDia.
MonoDia. Tell me.
Has nothing to do with the kissing mono.
Oh.
And nothing to do with Dia, which is God? No, it does. Wait a minute. Mono is for monologue.
Correct.
Dia is for dialogue. And it's still an alternative worship experience, but we're renaming it
to
MonoDia.
MonoDia. Now, you know, someone, I was bouncing the idea off of someone, and they said, well, why aren't you calling it MonoDia? So it's dialogue. I just don't think it sounds as good.
It sounds much more classy when you say Dia.
Dia, yeah.
MonoDia.
MonoDia.
It just rolls off the tongue.
There you go. And that's what's important, right?
Yes, of course. So, happy croissant day. By the way,
you didn't bring me a croissant. Mm. Oh, is really today?
It is. I didn't know it either.
Neither did I. But
I was in the drive-thru. It said happy croissant day, so I got one.
So I just had a sandwich before we came on air. I mean, I literally was cramming down because this is the only time I get to eat breakfast is on a Sunday, is right before we start this. So I pick up something on the way. I got a sandwich that was made on a croissant.
Oh, well, there you go.
Woo-hoo.
Look at us.
We're
paying homage to the croissant day tradition.
So when you heard when you heard the intro warning you might be at risk of a heart attack or the shocking truth about your child's school, did that catch your attention?
For sure. I thought, where are you going with this one? Really?
But
it's too early for that.
But isn't that what fear does?
Mm-hmm.
And then once you can create fear, then it comes with it is a sense of doubt.
Right away.
Yeah.
Yeah.
It's like, ooh, could that be me?
The adrenaline kicks in and you think, uh-oh.
Yes. Could this be my kid's school? Could it be my grandchildren's school?
Right.
Could it be me that might be having the heart attack and I'm not even aware of it? And it doesn't matter how old or young you are.
Right.
Heart
not
attacks.
Anymore. All right.
Yeah. So there's a text that talks about doubt.
There is.
Yeah.
Would you like to hear it?
I would.
Okay. I'm going to read it for you. It's from John, chapter 20, 24 to 29.
Now, John, is that a friend of yours?
The Gospel of John.
Oh, okay. Sorry.
We're going to the Gospel.
Okay.
I do know a John, but he did not write this.
Okay.
Now, Thomas, also known as Didymus, this is doubting Thomas.
This
correct?
Is doubting Thomas, and you. And actually, congrats on the pronunciation.
Thank you. It was a guess. Anyway, Thomas was one of the 12, and he was not with the disciples when Jesus came. So the other disciples told him, "We have seen the Lord." But he said to them, "Unless I see the nail marks in his hands and put my finger where the nails were and put my hand into his side, I will not believe." A week later, his disciples were in the house again, and Thomas was with them. Though the doors were locked, Jesus came and stood among them and said, "Peace be with you." And then he said to Thomas, put your finger here. See my hands. Reach out your hand and put it into my side. Stop doubting and believe. Thomas said to him, my Lord and my God. And then Jesus told him, because you have seen me, you have believed. Blessed are those who have not seen and yet have believed. I also have some a sage quote I'd like to share with everyone before we go to break, before the monologue. How's your Yoda expression? Or impression?
Oh, Yoda impression. Yeah. No, ooh, it's not it.
Star Wars.
Yeah. Oh. Okay.
Yoda, the sage,
yes.
The green guy.
Yes.
Okay.
Sorry.
So here's his wisdom on this. This is from The Phantom Menace. Did you watch that movie?
I did not.
Are you serious? Have you ever watched Star Wars?
Two of them.
Okay.
Just not a big fan.
Oh, great. Well, you should. You're missing out. Just
okay.
Saying.
Okay.
He says, fear is the path to the dark side. Fear leads to anger. Anger leads to hate. Hate leads to suffering. And we'll be right back.
You want to get people's attention. You want to be able to just draw them in, pull them in, so that you can get them to do what you would like or try something, maybe even buy something. Use fear. Because fear works. And the media understands this. The headlines that we started this podcast with, you can find those throughout the internet and on social media platforms and on the news. In fact, I Googled fear in headlines, and I found some places that would tell you how you can create a headline that will draw someone in by using fear. Well, for the last year and a half, you and I, we have been experiencing a slow burn of fear, kind of this underlying thing that's a part of us. Maybe at times we're not even aware of it. And it's the virus, COVID-19. When that hit, we realized that we had something brand new. And as it quickly spread from China and throughout the world, this pandemic, there was so much that we didn't know about it. And because of that unknowing, it created a sense of fear in us. And then we even got more afraid and more frustrated because the science kept changing its mind. Because we don't want uncertainty, because we don't like uncertainty, well, in turn, what ends up happening is that we expect something from science that it can never provide us. For the last year and a half, we have actually been able to watch how science works. It's been amazing. Because science is always, with this virus, discovering something new. That's why some people say, we're frustrated when from the very beginning it says, well, you know, we really don't need masks. And then all of a sudden we needed masks. And then now we're being told with the Delta variant that there is only certain types of masks that will work effectively. And that is frustrating. And that does create this sense of fear. Fear, especially if you're a parent and you have children that have not been able to be vaccinated yet. That can create all sorts of feelings inside of you that's like, oh, this is really uncomfortable. Think about recently, the Biden administration told us, they said, we're looking at boosters. Boosters were supposed to be coming out this month, middle of this month, for those who were older. Now, all of a sudden, we're calling that into question. These create a sense of us of frustration. And out of that frustration comes this underlying sense of fear, because who will give us a sense of certainty? Who will give us this feeling of like, yeah, everything's okay? But there is something that happens that does create a sense of certainty for people, and that is God. A lot of people, when they feel uncertain or when they feel afraid, they turn to God and religion as a means by which they are able to deal with their fears. They double down on faith. This sense of like, yeah. This is what I believe. This is what I believe about God. God is in control. Everything's okay. I'm just going to have more faith. And then this faith, these set of beliefs that we have, what they end up doing is they become the means by which we interpret our experiences. So we have these different experiences, and if they evoke fear, then we turn to faith, these beliefs, in order to calm our fears. And the majority of time, it works. The majority of time. But occasionally, we have these experiences that when they occur, what we believe doesn't align with that experience. And as much as we try, it just doesn't click. So in turn, we try to double down on our faith. But if we're not able to, then we feel guilty and afraid because we don't have enough faith. And who are you going to tell? Because by not having enough faith, you might be disappointing God. And who are you going to tell in your community that may not judge you or look at you or maybe feel like, well, if they'd get their act together, they would have enough faith. And so when this fear is not able to be dealt with and resolved, then it creates these doubts. And then we begin to create doubts in our mind around God and in religion. And that takes us directly back to that text from the Gospel of John that Janelle read for us. Thomas, here's a man who was told by his friends that his leader, his master, his teacher was dead. And then we was told that he had risen from the dead. That just doesn't happen, right? And rather than going, oh, yeah, I understand. Instead, what happens is Thomas goes, no, I'm not going to believe you. You guys, maybe you're pulling my leg. So Thomas ends up doubting. And listen again to what Jesus says in the fourth gospel, verse 29. And then Jesus says to Thomas, "Blessed, because you have seen me, you have believed. Blessed are those who have not seen and yet believed." Now, there are many people that will look at that text, and earlier where it said, Thomas, quit doubting, they look at that as a criticism against Thomas and doubting. And they double down on in this and saying, see, that's why you don't doubt God. On the other side, there are individuals who believe the reason the story is in there might be to encourage us to doubt. Now, think about that. Is it possible that we find value in doubting? Especially, maybe even doubting God and some of our religious beliefs. Frederick Buchner says the following: whether your faith is that there is a God or that there is not a God, if you don't have any doubts, now here's where it just nails it in my opinion, you are either kidding yourself or you're asleep. You ready for that? Whether your faith is that there is a God or that there is not a God, which, by the way, it takes just as much faith to believe there is not a God as there is a God, then, and if you don't have any doubts, either you're kidding yourself or you're asleep. But let's just be honest with each other. Doubting is painful. When you begin to have doubts and question what it is that you have believed, something that has been passed on to you, the majority of us, we don't come to our beliefs in a vacuum. They were passed on to us. So we have a sense of belonging by holding on to those beliefs. But when you begin to doubt those, it creates this sense of pain, this angst that you feel inside. You're not sure what to believe anymore. And that emotion, that feeling of doubt, is one that we try to avoid. But even if we can just learn to sit with those doubts, it will benefit us in the long run. Why? Well, here's what I found to be very interesting, is that a quote from Khalil Gibran, who is a poet, he says the following: doubt is a pain too lonely to know that faith is his twin brother. One more time. Doubt is a pain that is too lonely to know that faith is actually its twin brother. See, a lot of people have so much confidence in their belief systems and their certitude of who God is that's not really faith. Faith becomes a noun. Faith becomes a set of beliefs. When you doubt, all of a sudden you find that doubt is, as this writer has said, is closely part of faith. Silver dollar coin, two sides. One side is doubt. On the other side, faith. Without both sides, you got no coin. And that is the value of doubt. Doubt is what builds our faith. And again, please understand, the kind of faith that I'm talking about is not the same as belief in improbable supernatural things or a belief that everything works out for the best. That is not the kind of faith that I'm talking about. Instead, the kind of faith that I'm talking about is the verb side. It's an experiential. It's a way of living. Okay, now I'm going to share with you a statement. And I want you to try to pay attention to how you respond within your body, within your mind, within your emotions. And here it is. Faith grows only as we question what we are told. It's almost as if you take your beliefs on a test drive. It's like, how does this work for me? These things that I used to believe, do they still feel comfortable? Or are they no longer applicable? You see, even the other spiritual masters, people that were attuned with the transcendent, they understood this. The Buddha is said to have said the following: don't believe anything just because I have said it. Don't believe anything just because an elder or someone you respect has said it. Put it into practice. See for yourself if it is true. So perhaps the writer of the fourth gospel, perhaps he had something when he said that the Spirit would lead us into all truth. I used to be a professor at a conservative liberal arts college. And I remember one time that the president of the college called me in. And he said, some of your students are complaining because you're saying that the Spirit doesn't lead people into all truth. And I said, well, I said, I guess if you look at truth as being just a set of beliefs, then I have a hard time believing that the Spirit leads people to believe certain things. Because if people don't believe it like I believe, then I have to say that they're ignoring or the Spirit isn't talking to them. But instead, if I can see that faith, truth, is something deeper, it's a deeper understanding about oneself and others and the earth, if I can grasp that, then all of a sudden, faith turns from a set of beliefs to an experience. Experience that I live with. Before COVID, my wife would drag me occasionally to retail stores to buy clothes. I don't like it. I mean, I do not like going clothes shopping. Because I got to go in there and try on all these different clothes. to see what fits. You know, is it long enough? Is it too tight around the waist? Is it too tight on the legs? And then, unfortunately, sometimes I have found, the older I'm getting, that as much as I exercise, as much as I watch what I eat, sometimes weight comes on. And so all of a sudden I realize that instead of getting that size of pants, now I got to get this size of pants. So I don't like the experience. But it's needed. So I wonder sometimes if that's what doubt can lead us to. Is a new type of faith, a faith that is like trying on. See how it fits. See if it works for you. And remember this, just as your body changes over time and you got to get new clothes, the same thing happens with our faith. So allow doubt, allow room for it. Because doubt and faith, remember, they belong together.
Well, now we're going to dialogue. I'm kidding. Dialogue. And remind
right
me.
Right when you said that, I took a sip of coffee. It's like, it's how great. Do I not?
He's about to spit that everywhere. Remind me never to take you clothes shopping. Wow.
Thank you. Thank you.
That was such a rant.
I do not like it at all.
Okay. I don't think there's many men that do, just to be honest.
I don't know.
Oh, all right. Well, you know what? I really, really felt like what you said about doubt being painful.
Yeah.
Really resonated with me. And
tell me more, if you're comfortable, to the degree you're willing to disclose.
Absolutely.
How? In what way is it painful for you?
It just faces. You just have to face it. Like, you want to just push it away. And think, there's something wrong with me if I'm doubting this, especially if it's God. Well, so maybe that's where we need to start. Like, the question that you want to ask is, do you even belong to the theist tradition, first of all?
Again, I guess it goes back to...
What's your orientation to the divine, is what I'm saying.
Yeah, I think for me, it goes back to... The doubts created for me around God happened when I had that's a good question. It hit me when I began to think about how God is involved in our world. And there was a time, Janelle, when if I needed a new set of tires for my car.
Yeah.
And we didn't have the money.
Yeah.
It's when we were first married, starting out.
Right.
I'd pray to God for that.
For tires.
Yeah.
Okay.
I would pray to God for jobs.
Mm-hmm.
And then I started hearing stories about people who did pray to God about the life of someone they loved who was ill or sick.
Right.
And nothing happened. So all of a sudden I began to think about, is God more interested in me getting tires on my car or that I get this job than God is someone's health?
Somebody's life.
And then I think about what happens to individuals that are going without food.
Yeah.
I think about what happened over in Afghanistan.
Yeah.
And it's like, well, if that's God, and if God is the one who... breaks into our world and God mm-hmm. is external from us, that became very uncomfortable for me.
Yeah.
And so while I would say that I'm not an atheist,
yeah,
I would say that I am a non-theist. And really, those two things, they mean the same.
What do they mean, then?
Atheist, so if you take the word theist, and in Greek, all you have to do is add the word A or alpha uh-huh. in front of it, and it negates it. So the idea being that we've become to believe that atheist means you don't believe in any God. And that that's the normal understanding.
Yes.
So when you say that you're an atheist, then automatically people say, well, you don't believe in God.
Right.
But if you say that you are a non-theist, it's a clearer way of being able to say to someone, a theistic idea of God doesn't work for me.
Mm-hmm.
And so it really was hard for me.
Yeah.
To switch that view of God, of no longer seeing a theistic idea of God. Now, I may be wrong. That's where my doubt comes in. I may be wrong. And if I am wrong, then I hope
mm-hmm.
that whatever God is, if God is, as Jesus says, love,
mm-hmm.
then God might give me a pass because I got it wrong. But all I can do is use, you know, what I got. And
so is it fair to say you took the doubt and the fear and you made room for that?
Yeah.
And then it morphed or changed your point of view.
Yes.
Your orientation.
Yes. One time I was talking to Reverend Bill Nelson. He is the founder of the Church of the mm-hmm. Beatitudes. And I asked him one time, I said, is it possible to have faith
mm-hmm.
without being an agnostic?
Okay, let's explain what agnostic is before
someone
you
someone who's
that.
Not sure if there is or isn't a God.
Okay. And what was his reply?
So I asked him, I said, is it possible to have faith without being an agnostic? And he said, no. That was his answer. No.
Just no?
No, because that's faith. I mean, if you are so certain about mm-hmm. your ideas of God,
yeah,
then who needs faith? And,
yeah,
and there,
yeah.
and there is
okay,
no room, and there
that.
Is no room for doubt. There is no room, and any time that fear even begins to peek its head out of the hole, it's like whack the mole. Right?
Faith goes beyond the reasonable, doesn't it?
Yes. It transcends reason. But again, understand.
So,
but it's an experience.
Uh-huh.
You experience something. For example, I can be... I remember sometimes when late at night... Man, it was so much fun. We used to go water skiing, and we had a slalom course to set up.
At night?
And at night, we would go... We had these two big lights, one shining in the front,
uh-huh.
and one shining out the back. And... And so as you went
that
around,
had to take faith.
Yes. So as you went around, the buoy, the person in the back of the boat, they would take the spotlight and they would shine it at the next buoy. So you were going across the boat's wake,
okay,
flying across. I mean, what they say is if the boat is going, let's say, 36 miles an hour,
mm-hmm.
they're saying that when you pull hard against the boat, when you go across that wake, you could actually be doubling the speed. So you could be going anywhere from 60 to 70 miles
what?
An hour, flying across. It is exhilarating. I mean, it's exhilarating.
Okay.
And you're going across it, and you can't see it. All you can see is the buoy.
Okay.
And that, to me, I remember after skiing in the dark like that, there was just this feeling of, it was... And so that was experiential. It pulled me out of...
Uh-huh.
myself into something beyond myself. And I think maybe...
Fear?
No. No, no, no. And no doubt. It was just pure adrenaline rush.
Okay.
And I think... But that goes back to what we were saying, Janelle, is that, to me, is maybe what faith is. It's something that we experience, and it draws us beyond just ourselves into something more. And maybe that's where we find... the transcendent, or what people call mm-hmm. God.
Maybe. Through the struggle. I like what Richard Feynman
and the joy.
Said.
Ooh, pulling the big names.
Oh my gosh. let me just say something about Feynman. He is a god in my family's household.
Okay.
He's a theoretical physicist. My dad was a nuclear physicist.
Ooh.
And so Feynman was part of our vernacular. We talked about him quite often. And he actually said that by recognizing our ignorance and leaving room for doubt, that's so important because that's where the struggle is. And I think it's important that we don't forget the struggle.
Mm. Yeah.
So.
Well, and help me, how often are we not comfortable with the struggle?
All the time.
Yeah.
Yeah. We just don't want to sit in that. That I want comfort. I want answers. I want certainty. I've shared this before.
And that's why I think these weighted blankets are selling so well.
Weighted blankets.
Yeah.
What are you talking about?
You get these blankets that they're really heavy.
Oh, right.
I think it gives us that feeling of security, this feeling of it's mm-hmm. it's something that is, you know, evolution placed with that we grew up into is this feeling of security. That's how you survive, is feeling safe.
Yeah. And who wants to sit in the uncomfortable and be cold without that blanket?
Exactly.
But then it can also be claustrophobic, don't you think?
Exactly.
Okay. Yeah. So there you go. We need both sides of the coin. Nice prop, by the way.
Thank you.
Can I have it?
We'll see how you do the rest of the podcast.
Dang.
So let me ask you.
Hmm.
And again, you don't have to answer this, but what about you in your own spiritual, religious journey? Have you had the moments of doubt? You know, they often call them the dark night of the soul.
Yeah, that's what's happened. I remember Mother Teresa had that.
Yeah.
So several people have that.
Yeah, what about you?
I think I'm still in the dark night,
so
quite honestly.
So like, you are having doubts. You're
I'm still navigating through what I thought I understood.
And how comfortable is that?
Not really very comfortable.
Do you ever get moments, though, in the midst of this new journey
mm-hmm.
where you feel a little bit of a euphoria? It's like, oh, I never knew. It's that eureka moment.
I think I feel like I'm still seeking certainty.
Okay, tell me more.
I don't want to just sit with these new ideas.
Mm.
I'm glad, I guess.
So in some ways, you don't want to sit with the doubt.
I don't.
You're willing to tolerate it, and then eventually the doubt will go away and you'll get the certainty.
Thank you. Yeah, I'm getting there.
So what would you tell someone who's listening to this podcast mm-hmm. right now? What would you tell them if they're in the same situation that you are right now?
Seek community, for one thing, and somebody to talk to about it. I think that's important.
Can't that be dangerous?
Yeah, it can be, for sure.
I mean, if you talk to the wrong person.
Yeah, but I think that there are communities out there, believe it or not. In fact, we happen to be a part of one.
Yeah, agreed.
That there are a lot of people that would be more than willing to talk about doubt and fear that you might have.
When I was a professor at that college, one of the things, again, one of the times I got called in, this time it was by the academic dean.
You got called in a lot, didn't
I did. You? I did. In fact, that's why he ended up leaving, was because one time the president called me in, and again, and he said to me, he said, you know, you're like a square peg we're trying to fit into a round hole.
Mm.
And if you get a chance to leave, you probably ought to take it.
Oh.
Yeah.
Yikes.
But when the academic dean called me in one time, he said, you know, we're hearing that you raise a lot of questions to students. And I said, well, if we're a liberal arts college, aren't we supposed to be teaching critical thinking?
Uh-huh.
And he said, yes, we are. But then give them the answers.
Oh.
Exactly. And especially in the area of religion. You can question in the area of science. You can question in the area of psychology. But when it comes to religion, we tend to have this taboo around it, around asking questions about God and our beliefs, because it does exactly what you described, Janelle.
Yeah.
it creates a discomfort. I mean, parents would call the college and say, look, we're paying a lot of money to send our kids to this college.
Right.
And you have a professor there who's causing them to have doubts.
Shut him down.
Yeah.
But I think it's so important to really, we have an inner attitude about God's existence.
What do you mean by that?
Well, I think it's almost an intuition. I don't know. For me, it's hearing an inner voice that I don't want to ignore anymore.
Yeah.
And so we need to go with that. Be aware of it. Sit with it.
Yes.
And then also realize that there are other people doing the same thing. That means a lot. Well, that you're not alone.
And I think what you're describing, Janelle, is looking at God. Mm-hmm. And religion in general,
yes,
from more of an intuitive than from an objective.
Yeah, exactly.
Yeah. And I think that shift takes place, and as it takes place within ourselves, it actually impacts our view of God.
Yeah.
Because if you see God as theistic, mm-hmm, then God is the one who breaks into our world. God is the one who reveals things to us.
Yeah.
And you really don't have to use more of what you were talking about, that voice inside of yourself, that intuitive sense of, like, does this work for me? Without faith and doubt, you won't feel that.
You'll just sit in it, cruise control.
Exactly. And for a lot of people, that brings a great deal of comfort.
Right.
To believe that you have this God,
yeah,
who tells you what is truth. And I think that's one of the frustrating things for me as a minister.
Yeah.
Is that there are certain people that look to me and people in my occupation as the ones to tell them what is truth.
Correct. Just like at the college.
Yeah, and if you think about it, the Bible was written by human beings.
Uh-huh.
Now, you could say that the Spirit was involved in that, and that's a whole nother argument.
Yeah.
But it was human beings that decided what went into the Bible and what did not.
Correct.
Some things were left out. And it was human beings that decided that the idea of a virgin birth,
mm-hmm,
that was brought in. The idea of salvation.
Yes.
That God needs atonement. God needs to see death in order to forgive. That was created by humans.
Right, but then there's the argument it was divinely inspired.
And so
what do you do with that?
My question would be, are you divinely inspired? Are our listeners divinely inspired?
Wow, that puts me right on the spot. Like, literally.
Yeah.
That's where I'm at right now.
I mean, we have this idea that God worked in people's lives.
Uh-huh.
In the past. And then all of a sudden, God reveals God's self to us in the past, and then God gets quiet. Now, the United Church of Christ, they say that God is still speaking. But again, that idea alone is based on, in this is just my opinion, a theistic idea, understanding of God. But if you have a non-theistic view of God, then whatever that God is a part of all of it. God is a part of every. And so that's, I go back to what you said, and I think you nailed it. And so because you nailed it, you get the coin.
Oh, wow. Great.
That's actually on 1776. It was minted in 1976.
Aww.
For the 200 year celebration. And now I'm going to take it back because it was my mother's.
Oh, okay.
Sorry.
Well,
Indian giver.
That trumps me. You know what? I read something yesterday. Science is what makes sense of the material world. And religion is quite the opposite. And it's funny how religion or faith is irrelevant to science, but science is not irrelevant to religion. Two sides of the coin.
Science.
Religion.
Religion.
Yes.
I mean, to a certain degree, they're different because they're both, there's one in each, right? They're different sides.
But one has undermined the authority of the other.
It depends how you see science and how you see religion. They don't have to. We can meld the two together.
True.
And you can allow instead of having this rigid set of beliefs.
Yeah.
That for a time can give you a great deal of comfort. Instead of having that, if you have more of a fluid sense.
Mm-hmm. Okay.
Then that creates the discomfort that you're talking about.
Yeah.
But in the long run, I think people either, when they're facing a crisis of their faith or their beliefs,
mm-hmm.
I think you either double down harder.
Yeah.
And you beat yourself up and you just got to have more faith and pass the, you know, don't.
Right.
I mean, literally, I've had people in my life no longer talk to me because of the, by talking to me, it raises doubts for them.
Yeah.
So instead, or even being around someone who has doubts makes you kind of like, ooh, this doesn't feel right, so I shouldn't be their friend or I shouldn't hang out with them.
Right.
But instead, if we allow those doubts to happen,
mm-hmm.
I think it creates an exciting life.
Yeah.
But it takes a while to get there. It doesn't.
Right.
And I think, again, that goes back to community.
It takes courage.
Yeah. And if you find it with each other, and if you can be a part of a community, I mean, to go it alone, that's one of my frustrations, is that people who have completely walked away from church.
Yeah.
How do they deal with it? Because it's like, if you have these are real questions.
Mm-hmm.
You know, it's almost like religion and philosophy. These are deep questions that impact our lives.
Right.
And to ignore them, I think, creates all sorts of challenges for me.
Yeah, and I think if you wait until it becomes absolutely necessary to face them.
Right.
You know, you're at death's door, or, you know, a sickness, or,
you know,
that's not the time to face big things.
A colleague of mine who is a history professor,
mm-hmm.
he told me one time, he said, Tony, it seems like when you are teaching,
mm-hmm.
that you're not only leading the horse to water,
mm-hmm.
you're forcing the horse to drink, and you might actually end up drowning him.
Wow, yeah.
So I think there is an element of sensitivity.
Yeah. Put the brakes on.
Right. There's an element of sensitivity to where people are at. There are times when people are not ready to face harder questions. And I think that's where, it goes back to community, that you respect that. And you don't, I mean, ultimately, it boils down to how we treat each other. I mean, it's not a matter of being who's right or who's wrong, because, again, that goes back to faith and doubt. If you have faith and doubt, you're mm-hmm. probably not overly fervent to impose your ideas upon other people, because
you're not comfortable yourself.
Right. But when we do feel that urge and that mm-hmm. prompting to want to impose our ideas on other people, I think we're coming from a different place.
Hmm. Very true.
Yeah. And it says more about me wanting to do that. And I catch myself, Janelle. Dang, I catch myself.
Really?
Oh, especially if I'm like first Fridays when we're walking
mm-hmm.
and I see these guys screaming. Man, I just want to mess with
Let's explain for the listeners what First Friday is.
Well, you explain it.
It's every first Friday of the month here in Phoenix, downtown. They open up the streets, and artisans set up booths, and there's
food
trucks. It's a whole culture in and of itself.
And then the people on the corner screaming about people going to hell.
Yeah.
And there's a part of me that gets triggered.
Yeah.
And I just want to go there and mm-hmm. show them that they're wrong. And there are a couple times I've done it, and it's...
Well, it's upsetting.
I know.
I've brought people there that have a small... My daughter's friend was like mortified when she heard this guy screaming yeah. through the megaphone.
Yeah. And I think, but again, to try, that's a whole nother issue when it comes to, yeah, that he has freedom of speech.
Right.
But it's also my freedom not to be bombarded by your speech. I think ultimately, though, it comes back to what you were saying, because we need to wrap this up. You give me your parting idea and I'll give you mine. What would be the one thing you would want our listeners to walk away with from this MonoDia, this episode?
Dig down really deep and find the courage to allow yourself to experience the doubt and the fear, and then reach out to speak with others that also walk in that same direction right now. And Beatitudes is one place to find that community.
And for me, I would say, building off of the last word that Janelle just said, a sense of community. There's not a lot of places in our society where we can have these conversations, where we can talk about God and we can talk about humanity and raise questions and be honest with our fears and our doubts. And I think it's essential that we find that place. So wherever you are, I would encourage you to find a place that you can have that sense of community. As we come to a close, I'm going to ask you to do me a favor. If you have taken the time to listen to this podcast all the way through, then apparently you feel it was interesting enough and it may have impacted your life. So I'm going to ask, if you think there's someone that is going through this time of difficulty, of perhaps like the dark night of the soul and doubts, and rather than you feeling like you have to pull them out of that, if you want to just let them know that it's okay and that there's other people that get it and that are going through it, please share with them this podcast, and might be a way that you can encourage them and help them. So this draws us, our time together, to an end. Have a wonderful day. And no matter what you're doing out there, stay safe. Take care.